Next, four urban explorers venture back in time to uncover the lost ruins of the Windy City, Chicago, Illinois.
Open access door.
Check it out. Oh, wow. Come on, I don't know if I should get in there.
Across the nation, the relics of America's past lie abandoned and forgotten. Factories, theaters, missile silos. This is the realm the homeless call home. A netherworld of rats and toxic waste. And these are the chronicles of the Forbidden Zone expeditions. A series of inner treks to find and explore America's lost archaeological wonders and bring them back to life.
Go.
This week's destination is the birthplace of the gangster speakeasy, the home of monster steaks and the cradle of modern jazz, Chicago, Illinois. No longer the second city, Chicago is now a world-class destination. But success has a price, and that means that many grand structures that made this place great are not long for the modern world. Site 1. The secret network of freight tunnels buried beneath downtown Chicago. If our team can find their way through this lost world, they might learn what the Great Chicago Fire had to do with the birth of the modern skyscraper. Site 2, Al Capone's hidden speakeasy. This gangster hideout, where the women were easy and the whiskey flowed like water, is rumored hidden right beneath one of Chicago's favorite night spots. Site 3, the Uptown Theater. Stars from the Astors to the Grateful Dead made it world famous. Now it stands completely abandoned. Legend has it that somewhere inside lies a master safe, unopened and forgotten. For our urban explorers, Chicago's time capsules conceal priceless artifacts, each with a secret to reveal. This week's urban explorers are Bryce Tupper, structural engineer, Steve Duncan, urban historian, and world-class climbers Brittany Griffith and Timmy O'Neill. Stick with them and venture into hidden corners of the city that even the locals don't know exist. Exploring Chicago means buildering, the urban sport of climbing tall buildings.
Nice work.
All right.
This rooftop position reveals their first destination, Chicago's famous downtown, the Loop. Somewhere beneath it lies the forgotten freight tunnel system.
Hey! Here we are, welcome to Chi-Town, Chicago. We've got three main objectives here. The freight tunnels that run underneath the city, the Al Capone speakeasy, and also the old abandoned Uptown Theater. You kids ready for this?
Absolutely. Yeah!
Well, then step on it, let's do it! Yeah.
First stop, the Loop. Downtown Chicago, renowned for its beautiful collection of early skyscrapers. And although many Chicagoans don't know it, an abandoned underground rail system 60 miles long connects the basements of many of these buildings. Now through a secret passage, the team enters a world that only a handful of living Chicagoans have ever even seen.
Check it out.
I've wanted to get into the freight tunnels for years now, but especially after September 11th, it was not easy to get in. I mean, those things run underneath almost every major Chicago landmark. So yeah, I was way beyond thrilled to finally get down there.
I'm not doing this again.
Construction of the freight tunnel system began in 1890 and finished in 1906. Specially designed trains carried goods and heating coal to the basements of Chicago's downtown and carried out mail and ash. This 60-mile labyrinth was dug mostly by hand out of the blue clay at a painstaking pace of just 16 feet a day. To cover more ground, the team decides to split up. Bryce and Steve will seek remnants of the old rail cars that once ran down here. Timmy and Brittany will look for a hatch that leads beneath the Chicago River.
Okay, Timmy. We got tracks. This must be from the old carts that were down here.
Most of these tunnels were built by Polish immigrants working 16-hour shifts at a backbreaking salary of just a buck a day.
Ash. Because the congestion in the streets above from pedestrians.
Listen.
Oh, whoa.
Listen, dude, it's coming this way.
Oh, no, let's come on. Let's go. Red line downtown.
What is that? Is that the subway?
It's the L, yeah. The
is it really? It was interesting to be below the subway. It was interesting to be below the entire city because there's the hustle and bustle that's going on, and you're inside of the earth, encapsulated 40 feet below in a tunnel that was built 100 plus years ago. That kind of resonates with the history, and it was also reverberating with the subway, and you're not sure where you're going, you're not sure what's going on. I mean, it was really cool.
So that's where that tunnel was. This left right here.
A half a century after they were shut down, the tunnels still align perfectly with a modern Chicago tourist map.
Right. So keep going south.
Each individual tunnel is aligned with a street in downtown Chicago. It would drill access holes and then level from the streets above. And what I find most amazing about the tunnels are how straight and level they are given when they were built, kind of 1900.
Should we check the oxygen meter at some point?
I mean, this doesn't actually check oxygen. This doesn't check the gas.
Down here, toxic and explosive gases are often tasteless and odorless. That makes air safety monitors vital in any subterranean exploration. The butane from Steve's lighter pushes the gauge well into the danger zone.
Don't suck on lighters at home.
Okay, now we're going to real test, actually.
Okay.
Now it's still...
We're not even at zero.
We can still run out of oxygen, but we're not going to die of poisoning.
Oh, okay.
Early on, Bryce and Steve come upon one of the chutes that was used to dump burnt coal ash from a skyscraper basement into the rail cars.
Yeah, this must be one of those ash chutes.
Let's check it out.
Get up there?
I think I'm gonna pop up in someone's office.
Maybe. Or into the subway system.
It's pretty good, because looks like there's a buildup of ash on the bottom, which is giving me a lot of traction. I hear people talking.
Yeah?
Inches above Bryce's head, workers in a skyscraper basement converse, unaware that two strangers are listening in right beneath their feet.
Yeah. Can I come up with you?
Here. Come on up.
Steve should watch his footholds here. Each of those metal pipes contains about 25,000 fiber optic lines. The tunnel is full of them. This place might have been created to transport goods and coal, but today it funnels a different commodity around Chicago at the speed of light. Information.
What's in there?
Sweet, check this out. It's like this super old rusty pump.
I think that is an old pump.
It is original issue. You know what you should do?
Well, we need to get a shot of that.
Yeah, let's take a picture of it.
Let me see if I can get in there.
Halfway through the exploration, Brittany and Tim discover one of the original 1898 pumps that kept this place relatively dry. This one actually pumped water up and out through Chicago's sewer system, but was probably well out of commission in 1992 when a freak Chicago flood forced city residents to remember these lost tunnels. At the time, the city was building a new pier on the Chicago River. Even the government engineers forgot the tunnel system existed.
Yeah, I heard that they actually forgot that the tunnels were down there. And when workers drove a pylon into a section of tunnel below the river, it filled the tunnels and then flooded the basements of huge department stores and caused something like $1 billion worth of damage.
Yeah.
Merrimack Caverns.
Buzzkill.
What?
My feet have been dry up until this time.
Let's go. Come on.
No, I've gone this whole way without getting
my
feet wet.
Come on, you're a world-class rock climber, cavers.
I'm not a world-class diver.
Let's go. Come on.
Chicago sits on Lake Michigan, and the Chicago River slices right through downtown.
Yeah, and these are Gore-Tex.
Even a little rain can push both to overflowing. At 40 feet below street grade, the fact that the freight tunnels aren't completely flooded reflects how soundly they built this place.
You're at 40 feet, walking through mucky water that probably has malaria.
Come on,
this
Timmy.
Welcome to Chicago.
Lightweight.
Coming up, our explorers find objective number one and stumble into a potentially toxic situation. Deep in Chicago's secret freight tunnels, our urban explorers approach their first objective, one of the newer doors installed after these passageways flooded back in 1992. This one leads right beneath the Chicago River.
Open 1.5-inch diameter valve to check for high water level on the opposite side before opening access door, close valve.
Tim and Britt should heed the flood door instructions.
Do we have anything that's 1/2-inch to check? This is the 1.5-inch valve right here.
They're 40 feet below street level beneath a city that sits on a giant lake.
Well, if there's water, it could come rushing in and drown us.
Well, obviously.
Now, here's the deal. Let's throw caution in the wind and just open those one at a time. Go ahead.
Okay. Yeah. Okay, I'm opening it.
Trust it open.
Oh, it stinks, the air quality.
Hey, look who it is. It's Elvis Presley.
Their air monitor confirms this space is non-lethal. But what they're smelling is potentially toxic. A blend of sewage methane and dead air. Dead air can drop and suffocate utility workers in just seconds.
It smells like farts in here. I think this is probably the collection of all the farts of the people that built this tunnel. All the Irish, Italian, and Polish farts in the last 200 years. It's kind of like a fart preservation chamber. Come on, get in here.
I don't feel very well, I'm serious.
Look what you're standing in right now. Is it kind of gross or what?
Oh, it's all bubbling.
About 10 city blocks away, the rail cars have thus far eluded Bryce and Steve, who have hit a deep water dead end.
Yeah, I'll tell you what you'll find. You'll find water.
I don't mind getting soaked because I know it, you know, I'll go and get warmed up again sometime pretty soon. People worry a lot about diseases or tetanus or scrapes and this, that, and the other thing. There's just not that much that's truly unsanitary nowadays. I wouldn't want to roam around in hypodermic needles or whatever, but good clean dirt, little rusty water, never hurt anybody. I think this was a fire hose.
Oh, wait, junction, left, right.
Conjunction, what's your function? No, do not service disconnect.
Okay,
The emergency phone system Tim and Britt have found is more critical than they know. The fiber optic lines down here transmit most of downtown Chicago's data stream.
Check it out, here are all the phone numbers in the trolley tunnels. Look at, let's call the La Salle trolley tunnel.
It's left. I'm gonna call my mom. She'll be psyched. It's ringing, hold on.
Hello.
Hey, Mom. What's happening?
Who's this?
It's Timmy. Yeah. The fifth son. Hello. Yeah. Guess where I'm at? We're exploring.
Hi, Mom.
Urban adventure with Brittany. Yeah. I'm underneath the ground 40 feet.
Oh, my God.
Actually, come on. Lighten up. All right, we'll be careful. I love you. Bye. Things I'm insane. Ole. I wonder how Bryce and Steve are doing right now.
I wonder what they're doing right now.
Meanwhile, somewhere beneath Chicago's Sears Tower, Steve and Bryce stumble onto their primary objective, one of the tunnel system's old rail cars. It's littered with what seemed to be overhead electric connectors that once powered the trains.
Originally, they were going to run it off a third rail that was electrified, and it was going to be the first train in the country to do that, but they ended up after a few years switching to the trolley cable. So I think this is one of the original ones that, something like that. I'm not sure I've ever seen anything like it because, just 60 miles of connecting tunnels underneath downtown. This tunnel is a great example of what Chicago did that no other city in the U.S. could have done at the turn of the century. It's really one of the most beautiful things I've seen.
The tunnel system is an engineering marvel, but it would not exist were it not for the skyscrapers that loom above this space. A skyline itself made possible by the Great Chicago Fire of 1871.
Some say the fire started when a cow knocked over a lantern, but whatever the cause, it raged through the wooden buildings, killed hundreds, and basically leveled downtown Chicago. Afterward, they outlawed any wood buildings in the loop, and from then on, you really only saw brick, concrete, and steel construction down there.
Soon, magnificent new structures called skyscrapers filled the air. But as Chicago's skyline boomed, so did traffic on the dirty streets below. Horse carts, pedestrians, and newfangled things called automobiles.
By the 1890s, Chicago was really choking on its own success. The street congestion was so bad that they proposed using the freight tunnels to handle packages and coal deliveries to the skyscrapers downtown.
But just 30 years after they finished it, the freight tunnel's time was over. A faster, more maneuverable invention, the freight truck, rendered the tunnel trains obsolete.
Hey, radio, Bryce.
Bryce, what's happening?
Just looking for you guys. I think we're ready to go.
Oh, really? Okay, cool. Well, we'll meet you guys back there. We're probably like 10, 15 away at the most from where we came in.
They've done it. Explored a lost underworld that in the post-9/11 world is now visited by only a handful of Chicago workers each year.
Don't tell me you lost the keys.
Come on, I need it.
They're in there.
They're in the car.
Keys.
It's running.
They're in the, yeah, let's go.
With the freight tunnels behind them, it's time to refuel.
I am definitely hungry and Brittany is thirsty. You guys hungry? Okay, bang a left here.
Here's your prize, baby.
So Steve, why don't you give us a couple tidbits about Chicago? When did the kielbasa arrive?
With the Poles, which was mostly around 1890 and onward.
You can always count on Steve to do his homework. But night's already fallen and they haven't even found their next objective. The hidden speakeasy of Chicago's most notorious gangster, Scarface Al Capone. Four urban explorers have infiltrated a forgotten network of century-old tunnels beneath downtown Chicago. Now they're headed to a nightclub called the Green Mill Tavern that may conceal Lost Ruin Number 2, the underground speakeasy of Chicago's most notorious gangster, Scarface himself, Al Capone.
North on Michigan Avenue.
So even after Prohibition goes into effect, Americans are still the same crazy lushes as before. Well, Capone cashed in on it big time. By 1927, he was supplying 10,000 speakeasies in Chicago alone, and he was raking in $60 million a year. Insane amounts of money back in those days.
Yeah.
That's, you multiply it by 10, that's about $200 million a year in today's money.
$200 million a year.
Yeah, sweet,
the gangster lifestyle, man.
Illegal booze made Capone so rich he bought an armored Cadillac with inch-thick bulletproof glass. Supposedly, it could take corners at 100 miles an hour. Like Capone, the Green Mill dates back to 1920s Chicago. Capone even had a private booth here and claimed it was his favorite club in town. But between 1920 and 1933, places like the Green Mill went dry. Prohibition made booze illegal all across America. Today, booze is legal. The Green Mill is still going strong and run by a guy named Big Dave.
Thank you, sir.
If our urban explorers are lucky, maybe they can talk Big Dave into helping them find their next objective. Proof that Capone's lost speakeasy still exists beneath this club.
Big Dave.
Hi.
Are you Dave?
No. Are you Big Dave?
Either one.
Yeah.
Now that they found owner Dave Jamillo, they've got to convince him to let them explore the rooms buried beneath his club.
Look at her pipes, Dave. On three, you got ready? Look at her arms, Dave. Look at the pipes. She's a professional rock climber. One.
Move your beer.
Two.
He might put her
three.
On.
Come on, Dave.
So we're in the Green Mill, and Brittany decides to arm wrestle Big Dave, guy 6'5", 250 pounds, in order to get us down to the basement. I'm thinking to myself, there's no way we're getting down there.
Oh, meeting Big Dave from the Green Mill Lounge was really fun. He tried to play all tough with me, but I think I cracked him.
All the travel books claim Capone's lost speakeasy is down there, but this guy Dave is notorious for keeping people out.
Where are you from, Dave?
Chicago, what do you think?
I'm from Iowa. Iowa, come on, we're from the Midwest. We're all brothers and sisters. Family here.
I'm from New York. Dave,
no,
I'm from New York.
Oh, that ain't gonna
be
any.
Shut up!
So there I was. I'd come all the way from Brooklyn to see this legendary space. I mean, anyone can get into the Green Mill, but checking out the lost history beneath it, that's why I was there, and I wasn't leaving until he said yes.
Okay. They're the most amazing thing around. You can't keep them hidden. A treasure like this should be shared.
I'm kind of busy. I'll just tell you, there's a tramp door there. Yeah. Go down there, go down the stairs, go into a cave.
With Big Dave's permission, our team heads into a time capsule once inhabited by Chicago's most infamous mobster.
Al Capone's secret tunnel.
Don't go breaking my heart.
You ready, Brittany?
I'm grabbing a beer.
Great, you coming or you drinking G&T's?
I gotta get a to-go cup. He doesn't have to-go cups.
Thanks, Dave.
Coming. All right, here we go. We've got access. Thanks, Dave.
He said there's a gate with boards over it.
Yeah.
That's what he said. We gotta find it.
Okay, you got
it.
There's a gate we need.
You guys go that way. I'll go this
way. Oh, I found it.
Already?
Yeah.
That was easy.
Look.
Yeah, you found...
Oh, no, that's the beer cooler. Sorry.
That's a good find, too.
Can we make a little stop here?
It was extremely cool for Dave to let us down the trap door. Now we're going to have the chance to find out if there really are ruins of an old speakeasy down here. If it's true, then 80 years ago, this space would have been flowing with illegal booze and crowded with wasted, well-dressed, jazz-age people. By the way, they called them speakeasies because people were supposed to keep their location on the down low and speak easy about them.
Yes. It smells like my grandfather's wine cellar down here. It does. It's important.
Whoa. Oh, Steve! Dunk!
Okay, you got it?
Yeah!
Yes, man!
I don't know if this is really a tough...
This is so cool!
Oh my god, look at all the urinals!
Cockroach.
Good, because I gotta go!
There are 18 urinals! What's with this? Why would you ever need this many urinals?
So when we were exploring down the basin, we happened upon this old bathroom. You know, there was a wall of urinals and all this fancy tile work, porcelain tiles probably shipped in from China or something like that. It's weird to have found that in the basement of an old bar, but I guess if it was one of Al Capone's old speakeasy joints, he'd want to pee in style. You know, it wasn't anything definitive, but it was a pretty good clue.
This goes forever.
As they push farther beneath the Green Mill, Steve, Bryce, and Brittany have no luck finding other speakeasy artifacts. Soon they realize that despite what the travel books say about this space, Capone's secrets will likely remain just that. Secrets, as elusive as ever.
Is there an alarm? I guess, well, we'll see.
Where are we? Oh, now we're at Furniture USA, you guys.
Well, we've obviously come to a street exit and we still haven't found any ruins of the old speakeasy that we can verify. That bathroom may have been part of it, but we can't say for sure.
Back on the street, Timmy's decided to get a head start on site number 3. Right next to the Green Mill is Chicago's famous Uptown Theater.
Those guys leave me out here hanging to dry, so I think I'm gonna go look for a place to get in to the theater myself.
Next, Timmy's monkeying around atop the Uptown pays off.
Sweet, where are you guys? Hey, I just found a way in.
And the guys discover a working steel curtain born from a tragedy that took twice as many lives as the Great Chicago Fire.
Nice!
With Chicago's gangster past behind them, our team is about to venture into an urban explorer's dream, the Uptown Theater. The advent of television and the multiplex movie killed this place. Now boarded up and abandoned, it is home to 46,000 square feet of pigeon crap encrusted architecture, countless artifacts, and a master safe they're just dying to crack. Over the years, live acts performed at the Uptown. The Grateful Dead, Bob Marley, Bruce Springsteen. But from the day it opened in 1925, the real attraction was moving pictures. Variety called this place the most gorgeous movie palace in the world, and a palace it was. Its over-the-top architecture was meant to lead people into a fantasy landscape that served up not just a movie, but a vaudeville act, a cartoon, and a newsreel, all for a single 10-cent price of admission. Now, urban climber Timmy O'Neill is searching for a way to get the rest of his team into this forgotten landmark.
Here we are, five stories up. Uptown Theater, like a 100-plus-year-old building. And if we look up here, you can see there's totally way up. So the deal with climbing buildings like this is that you have to use your intuition. I mean, first of all, this stuff is really old. So the bricks could pop out, the metal is super rusty. You never know when something's gonna break. So you always have to be prepared for change. Whoa, check that shit out, pigeons everywhere. When you're crossing over terrain that's unfamiliar to you, don't be thinking about something else. Don't be thinking about your girlfriend. Don't be thinking about your job. Think about change. Think about where you are in the moment.
The structure Timmy's climbing used to boast a galaxy of light bulbs and drew in countless patrons. High atop the boarded-up building, Timmy's death-defying act is about to pay off.
Sweet. I knew I'd find a way in. Holy shit. Look at this place. No way. It's huge. I gotta call those guys. Bryce, do you read me?
Yes, I do, Timmy, over.
Sweet, where are you guys? Hey, I just found a way in. Look, here, what I want you to do is go back outside the Green Mill, and I'll get you guys in, okay? Over.
Sounds good. We'll be there in 2 minutes. Over.
This place is pretty cool. Yeah. Yeah. Wow. We gotta find a way to turn on the lights.
Their objectives in the Uptown are simple. Brittany and Tim will head up to the highest point in the structure. Bryce and Steve will head down to explore the bowels of the theater. Along the way, each pair will look for an unopened safe full of uncertain treasure, rumored to exist somewhere in this massive structure.
This is backstage. This is where it all happened.
Look at this set of wires down here.
Do you think if you chop
the ropes they're handling once helped prop masters pull or fly scenery backdrops on and off stage?
Yeah, with the Uptown Theater, the thing that hits you right away is the scale. Definitely. I mean, it was built a long time ago, back when engineering techniques weren't super defined, and it was, you know, it's the boldness of everything that went into it, the size. It's just awesome to be in there.
Do you think this was just a curtain, or was it for fireproofing?
This half-lowered curtain wasn't theatrical. It was actually a safety device.
An asbestos curtain that came down.
Oh, yeah, that was the Iroquois Theater, wasn't it?
Bryce is right. In 1903, the Iroquois Theater fire began when the flames from a calcium arc spotlight ignited the just-painted scenery of a musical called Mr. Bluebird. In less than 90 seconds, a wall of flame engulfed the audience, killing 600 people. That's twice as many as died in the Great Chicago Fire.
Look how thick this is. It's like a foot thick.
Wow.
After the Iroquois disaster, the city of Chicago made all of their theaters put up fire curtains just like this one.
And there'd be a guy standing right here. His one job, day and night through all of the performances, would be to yank on this cable to drop the curtain in case of a fire. Hey, Duncan, come on over here. Let's see if this thing still works.
This curtain, all 50 tons of it, was counterbalanced with weights so it could drop down and save the audience from any fire. As for the people on this side of the curtain, I guess they weren't so lucky.
Try it. There, here it comes. There it comes. Yeah! Nice!
That's good workmanship. Still working after, what, 73 years?
I know.
Or something?
The question is, how are we gonna get from backstage to into the main theater now? Wow.
In a terrace above one of the Uptown's seven smoking lobbies, Brittany and Tim check out the theater's ornate decor.
Check it out, look how ornamental this place is.
Oh, wow, look at the sculptures. That's freaky, look at that.
What, look, kind of the devil
like
mouth?
The kind of clown
yeah.
face.
Check it out, look at the chandelier, it hung from here.
Wow, look at how those beams are painted.
The rafters.
Yeah, but see, actually, all this is probably fake.
Fake?
Just, well, it's probably all just faux ornamental stuff. This is all plaster.
Please keep this door closed at all times. Man, it's it's those kind of signs that just draw you to it, doesn't it?
Well, especially if you're looking for a safe, you know?
Yeah, that's a good point.
In search of the safe, Steve and Bryce are about to confront one of the building's real dangers.
Yeah, it's just a little catwalk behind the stage scenery.
Nice. Oh, look at this. This whole block. Check out this block right here. Oh, man.
Hey, look at this stuff, actually.
Nothing.
That's
the same stuff, I think.
Organic fibers put in the plaster?
Organic.
Like grass. Or, you know how they used to put horse hair and straw on plaster? USGC. You know what this stuff is? Pyrobar? Flame retardant? This is pure asbestos.
Asbestos. You know what we shouldn't be doing is busting this stuff up. Let's keep moving, please.
Okay. Yeah, I guess we are pretty stupid with that asbestos. Extremely carcinogenic, right? But you can't blame us. Asbestos used to be as American as apple pie. In fact, as late as the 1970s, they were still coating little kids' pajamas with this stuff. They called it a miracle flame retardant. I think at the time, some people still knew that it would cause cancer, but I guess they just figured little Jimmy would rather die of cancer than burn up in his bunk bed.
Next. The guys throw some light on the team's dark journey.
Look at this place!
And a master safe left unopened for decades presents a challenge they can't handle alone. Their journey through Chicago's lost ruins has brought our urban explorers to their final objective, the enormous and abandoned Uptown Theater. Here, our team seeks to illuminate a time when regular movies were considered about as sleazy as pornography is today. Now, except for the occasional rustlings of rats, bats, and pigeons, the theater's dark passages are deadly quiet.
Danger, electric current, keep out. That sounds kind of hopeful.
Please do not touch anything. Look at these things. How old are they? We're gonna end up turning the front lights on. I think that's not what we want to do.
Grand Lobby, General Lights. You ready? Where do you think we are now?
We're coming.
Oh, here we go, Timmy Seats. Whoa. Oh my God. Look at that.
Look how huge this place is.
Let's just turn them all on.
Okay, turn them all on.
Look at this place!
Nice work, fellas, nice work!
Look at all the detail!
Yeah, it's unreal, huh? Let's go take a look downstairs.
It seems so fancy for a movie theater.
And being in those theaters, I could feel like the history of the place, the people, just the presence of what went on there. I really wanted just to step back into time and be in the gowns and watching the performances and sitting and smoking and drinking in those chairs and just being part of that era.
Careful.
How many people do you think sat in here?
I think it held 4,000 people.
So magnificent.
This lost space is magnificent, and that's kind of the irony. Estimates put renovation costs at $35 million. So unless the city saves the theater, it will likely face the wrecking ball. Whatever its future holds, the Uptown's past is a glorious one. When the theater opened in 1925, 12,000 people showed up, but the place only had seating for about 4,500 per showtime. All that week, the line to get in stretched for blocks. Back in the 20s, movies were considered sleazy and low-class entertainment. Movie theaters were called dens of immorality. That's why the architects who designed the Uptown made it as over-the-top elegant and therefore respectable as possible.
I can't get over it. This place is so incredibly ornate. When palaces like these were at their prime, the nation was in the depths of the Great Depression with a 30% unemployment rate. So movies were a means to a much-needed escape. After all, the films were about being rich or getting rich. So, for a couple of hours, everyone could at least feel like they were a millionaire playboy.
Look at these.
Well, yeah. We have electricity on here.
This needs some work. Yeah.
I was blown away by how rich it was and just how time-worn and untouched. It seems like the kind of place that if you knew it was around, everybody in the neighborhood would would go in there, would visit it just to see it, you know?
Someone has got to restore this thing.
It's like if you had a beautiful park with flower beds, people would go and look at it. They wouldn't, you know, just lock the fence and never visit it. So I was just stunned at how pretty it was and how lonely it was.
Lonely, but not alone. Like many ruins, the Uptown has ghost stories. A caretaker who has spent many late nights here swears that a woman dressed in white drifts down these aisles in the dead of night. Before each sighting, a chill fills the air.
This is probably the projection booth doors right here.
Where?
Just on left to right. You can see doors.
Oh, this is scary in here. Yeah.
In this place.
Can we get up here? I'm a little bit freaked out.
Okay, I'm coming. What?
I think it was a pigeon, but it scared the crap out of me.
Really?
Look at this thing.
Surprisingly, many artifacts in the film projection booth remain.
Switch right here.
It's just the actual projector.
You think that turned the lights on and off?
No, I think it turned the projection something on. What do you got, Brent?
I don't know. It's like these slot, these drawer things. What do you think? Oh.
It's
Do you think that they stored reels in here?
Yep, exactly. I'm pretty sure.
This cabinet was meant to contain a fire should some of the old 35mm film ignite.
Reel safety equipment right here. Check it out. That'd be a cool thing in your house.
Back in the 40s, a feature film could take up 5 giant reels. The film itself was made from nitrate, which was prone to combusting in chemical fires that water couldn't extinguish.
It's pretty wild how you got these fire protective bins because the actual cell was made with nitrate, so it was explosive, basically.
As Timmy and Brittany continued their trek up to the dome, 100 feet above the auditorium floor, Steve and Bryce make their way deeper into the bowels of the theater in search of the safe. Instead, they find 3 massive rooms filled with machinery that will provide one of the coolest discoveries of the expedition.
You think all this is air conditioning and
yeah, I think it's an air conditioned giant place. I can't figure this thing out because it seems like these would be compressors to pump the refrigerant through the system or to compress the refrigerant in the first place.
Steve's closer than he thinks. The original ads for the Uptown bragged about the theater's air conditioning and its healing vapors. This technology was truly revolutionary in its day. Cooling 46,000 square feet at that time, that was a miracle. The system followed the principles of a window air conditioner, but on a massive scale. Here's how it worked. The pump room created compressed carbon dioxide. The CO2 tanks were then charged into coils in the room next door. Once the coils reached about 40 degrees, massive fans blew air over them and then blasted the cooled air out through the building's ventilation system.
Ducks. Really duck.
Come on, let's beat it. Brittany, let's go.
High above Bryce and Steve, Britt and Tim are about to summit the theater's false dome. Doing so will mean venturing into the most dangerous space of the entire expedition.
Oh, I can look straight down this hole at the curtain of the stage.
It's 4 a.m. 8 stories above the others, our urban explorers are about to finally summit Chicago's immense and abandoned Uptown Theater. After an exhausting trek, they make their way through the suspended catwalks that honeycomb the massive false dome high over the auditorium.
I'm feeling exhausted. It's been almost 24 hours since we've been at this, and upon finding the theater here, recharged our batteries a bit, but we gotta stick with it and find that safe and crack it.
Has Chicago beaten you, or have you guys toasted Chicago?
Oh no, we got a little left.
It's pretty wild, huh?
One step off of the rusted catwalk, and 3 inches of decorative plaster is the only thing between them and a fatal fall to the auditorium floor below.
Whoa, I can look straight down this hole into this, the curtain of the stage.
Really?
I couldn't figure it out. It was a weird perspective.
Look how it's suspended. Look at it all.
I know. It's all held up by these
metal bands.
Ooh.
And look how they wrap over top of these giant I-beams.
Oh my God.
It's like this giant spider.
The dome and catwalks they're exploring are hung from nothing more than a series of sketchy, rusted iron strips.
The summit here, the dome, like 300 feet above the deck. And if you look in here at all this ornamental plaster, you can see they did all this casting work. And then you have this structure of this metal. And then what you do is just soak hemp in plaster, apply it to the mold, and then wrap it around the skeleton and suspend it. And you can see that they just paint it. And then from underneath, it looks like you have maybe marble or some type of alabaster type stuff. But come on, let's beat it. Brittany, let's go. Let's rock it. Come on.
We can do it, Timmy. Come on.
Let's go find those guys. Let's find the safe.
Do we gotta run, Duncan?
Some energy?
It's 5 a.m., and the team's long Chicago journey is just about over.
Oh, yeah, bingo! Here it is.
They found it. A 1922 Diebold combination safe with inch-thick steel.
This thing is even turning.
Okay, time to go brute force. Where are you guys?
The lock's not working, the rust sure is, Steve.
Illinois? Chicago?
It cannot be open until closing time, Steve. This place
it's
has
long
been closed
past
for
closing
like,
time.
Yeah, 20 plus years has been closed. Why isn't it open?
Okay, you guys have any listings for a locksmith?
After a six-hour search and a $700 locksmith bill, the safe secret turns out to be nothing more than a bunch of old maintenance keys and bolts.
Okay, your shotgun you're driving.
Eventually, the safe is popped open, and lo and behold, inside, no, which is fine for me.
Can you believe that? Keys and bolts. This is one badass city.
Badass.
What's the population of Chicago, Mike? 3 million?
3.4 million. It peaked in the 1950s at 3.6 million. Then it's been going downhill ever since.
You see that hawk?
That was a rad mohawk. You know one interesting thing, actually?
Let's hear it. Tell us that one interesting thing. I'll give you one more interesting thing. And the key phrase is one.
Whites are a minority in Chicago.
Wait, he's got to say it.
He's done.
It's sunrise over Chi-Town, and the team hits one last Windy City landmark, the beautiful Lake Michigan shoreline.
24 hours, Chi-Town. We checked out the city, explored it, and let's just say we loved it. You guys have been great. It's time to book. Get out of here. Got to bring these kids home. They're tired. Hey, forget about it.
Bye, Windy City.
Adios, Chicago.
Later.